Greetings, developers. This is Wesley Chun, software engineer and developer advocate here at Google. Welcome to today's episode, where we'll walk through the common code needed to access Google APIs. In the previous episode, we showed you how to set up an app using Google APIs in the Dev Console. Click the link if you missed it, as it's needed for this episode. Why the code walkthrough? Because using the same common code base, you can access any of our APIs. The code we'll look at is in Python, but you can use any language that's supported by the Google APIs client library. In the end, the HTTP calls generated by the library that go across the wire are the same regardless of which language you use. First, we'll look at simple API access, which requires an API key. An API key will only permit access to public data and obviously not authorized data, such as user information. Before we get to the code review, be sure to grab the API key from your project's credentials page. Now let's look at the code. On line one, we import the build function. It creates a service endpoint for interacting with an API. The concept is the same, but maybe slightly different in other languages. For example, in Java, there's a builder class with a build method. In JavaScript, there's a load function. .NET, Objective-C, and PHP have a service class. Line 2 is the API key you copied from the Dev Console. Note in production, you're not going to hard code an API key into source. It's not secure, right? Finally, in line 3, build creates that service endpoint to the API you wish to use. And that's it. Now for authorized access using OAuth2. Go to your project's credentials page again and download the JSON file after you've created those credentials. Click on the link to the earlier episode where we demoed how to do this and save it as client-secret.json on your file system. Now it's no surprise with the added security that there's more code. Let's break it down. We've got the imports at the top. In addition to build, we need HTTP objects for signed requests. That's line 2. The final import on line 3 gives us token storage from oauth2client.file and utility functions to create and run the OAuth flow respectively. OAuth scopes express the permissions you request users to authorize for your app. You may need one or more scopes. So on line 5, either you'll have one or more strings representing those scopes. In Python, you can have an iterable or one long space-delimited string. Line 6 is the client-secret.json file that you got from clicking the Download JSON button. When your app is granted access, the service sends back an access token, which is stored in the file on line 8. Line 9 is where your app tries to get a valid access token with which to make authorized API calls. If the credentials are missing or invalid, like being expired, lines 11 and 12 will create and run the OAuth flow to get a valid access token, which, if received, is stored in that file. Finally, once we have a valid access token, the last common step is to create a service endpoint to that API. You need to specify the API string and its version. The last parameter signs the HTTP calls with your credentials. You can get API names and versions in the docs. Congratulations, now you can make authorized API requests. At this point, we've covered both simple and authorized API access. Now you're ready to take on any Google API, so make sure you check out other episodes in this series. Click the link to get the client library for your development language and review the previous episode on setting up your project in the Dev Console. We look forward to seeing what you can build using Google APIs. This is Wesley Chun from Google, and we'll blast off with you next time on the Launchpad.